Bonjour tout le monde. Je suis ici aujourd'hui pour faire le point sur les barrages illégaux, que ce soit à Ottawa ou à nos frontières, comme à Windsor, à Coutts, à Emerson. Je veux aussi vous parler de la situation en Ukraine et de la rencontre de ce matin avec le président Biden et d'autres alliés. The illegal blockades are hurting Canadians, whether they're in Ottawa, Windsor, Coutts, or Emerson. They're endangering jobs, they're threats to our economy and to public safety. The blockades are hurting small businesses and neighborhoods. At the border, they're impacting trade, supply chains, and manufacturing. The people these blockades are hurting are everyday families, auto assembly workers, farmers, truckers, and blue-collar Canadians. This morning, I spoke with David Cassidy of Unifor, who told me how badly this is hurting workers in southern Ontario. We both agree that blockades are unacceptable and that they have to end for the good of all Canadians. Hier, j'ai convoqué le groupe d'intervention en cas d'incident avec plusieurs ministres et hauts fonctionnaires. On continue de travailler de près avec les municipalités et les provinces pour mettre fin au barrage. J'ai aussi partagé les plus récents développements avec les chefs des autres partis. J'ai insisté que tous les députés de tous les partis doivent dénoncer ces actes illégaux. On Wednesday, I spoke with Premier Ford, and yesterday with Mayor Drew Dilkins of Windsor to offer the full and continued support of the federal government. Minister Alcabra, as well as Ministers Blair, Mendicino and LeBlanc, are also in regular contact with their counterparts. Ontario's announcement this morning is responsible and necessary. We will continue working alongside all partners to get the situation under control. This morning, I had a direct call with President Biden to talk about our shared challenges at the border. I updated him on the situation, particularly in Windsor. We discussed the American and indeed global influences on the protest. We talked about the US-based flooding of the 911 phone lines in Ottawa, the presence of US citizens in the blockades, and the impact of foreign money to fund this illegal activity. President Biden and I both agree that for the security of people and the economy, these blockades cannot continue. So make no mistake, the border cannot and will not remain closed. I want to remind everyone that politicians don't direct police in a democratic society, but I can assure you that the RCMP is working with provincial and local police departments to enforce the law. Everything is on the table because this unlawful activity has to end, and it will end. Of course, I can't say too much more now as to exactly when or how this ends, because unfortunately, we are concerned about violence. So we're taking every precaution to keep people safe. But the absolute safest way for this to end is for everyone to return to your communities now. If you're still participating in illegal blockades, you're hurting your neighbors. So it's time to go home, especially if you have kids with you. Dans les dernières semaines, on a vu que des fonds ont été amassés pour soutenir les barrages, incluant des fonds provenant de l'étranger. C'est important de comprendre que ces fonds ne peuvent pas soutenir des activités illégales. Canada's banks are governed by laws, regulations, and practices that ensure funds cannot be used for criminal or illegal activity, and these blockades are illegal. Canadian banks are monitoring financial activity very closely and taking action as necessary. I want to make something very clear. The illegal blockades seeking to take our neighborhoods and our economy hostage and the collective COVID fatigue we are facing are two very separate things. If you joined the protests because you're tired of COVID, you now need to understand that you are breaking laws. The consequences are becoming more and more severe. You don't end up losing your license, end up with a criminal record, which will impact your job, your livelihood, even your ability to travel internationally, including to the US. We've heard your frustration with COVID, with the measures that are there to keep people safe. We've heard you. It's time to go home now. And to the people who are tired of this pandemic, that is, all Canadians, I want you to be able to get back to the things that you love. I hear you, all of you. Parliamentarians hear it in their communities. We all hear it from friends and family, from people like Laurie from here in Ontario, who wrote to me to say she disagrees with the bad behaviour of the blockaders, but she's also tired of the restrictions. Or Helen from Toronto, who's worried about what the restrictions are doing to children's mental health. I understand. We don't want these measures to last longer than they should, and we never did. But the truth is, because of all of our efforts, we saved more lives in Canada than in many other countries. We helped people like Samuel from Courtenay, BC, who also wrote to tell me that as a healthcare worker, our measures are keeping him safe. C'est parce qu'on a travaillé ensemble et qu'on s'est fait vacciner qu'on a récupéré plus d'un million d'emplois. On a demandé aux gens de se faire vacciner précisément parce qu'on veut éviter des confinements et des restrictions. Et c'est ce que les Canadiens ont fait. En regardant vers l'avant, on continue de travailler avec les responsables de la santé publique et de suivre les meilleurs conseils scientifiques pour garder les gens en sécurité et pour protéger les travailleurs de santé. Every day, we consider and reconsider what's possible and what's best to protect Canadians. I have multiple meetings every week to talk about what the next steps are. This morning, for example, I spoke with Dr. Tam and Minister Duclos, among others, about the plan to adjust travel measures under federal jurisdiction. As Canadians, it's important to continue being there for one another. We're fighting a virus. We're not fighting each other. People are making sacrifices and have been for the past 2 years. It's never the time to hurt our economy and fellow Canadians with illegal blockades, but especially not now. After all we've sacrificed together, after all we've done to get back to the things we love and reopen our lives. Avant de terminer, je veux parler de la situation en Ukraine. On continue de travailler de façon très proche avec le président Biden et nos alliés. Ce matin, on a eu un sommet virtuel pour discuter de nos efforts diplomatiques, économiques et militaires. During the summit with President Biden and allies, we discussed the importance of finding a peaceful solution. That remains our focus. We're all concerned that Russia is continuing to build up its troop presence and looking actively for excuses to act. Instead, Russia must de-escalate. The West is standing firm together, coordinated, and ready to impose severe costs, including sanctions, if Russia invades Ukraine once again. We're also strengthening our support and presence through NATO, and we will continue to support Ukraine democracy, sovereignty, and independence, and more than anything else, continue to support the people of Ukraine. This is an evolving situation, but the bottom line is this. We're not seeking confrontation with Russia, but we're resolved to stand firm with the Ukrainian people's right to determine their own future. Merci beaucoup.